They're called man's best friend, and for many pet owners, their companionship brings joy and happiness. On today's program, we'll hear about a ministry where dogs bring hope and healing to those in crisis. Their mission is to help spread the mercy and compassion of Jesus Christ. Stay tuned.
Covered every sin for everyone who calls upon the only name that saves. The great I am, His love is moving even in this place we stand. So every weary soul can find Your comfort and Your rest. Precious stone that day, and all our sins I pay. This is our salvation song. He brought us back to life. Jesus is the saving one. Forever we say His name. His name. There are no works and no sacrifices that could ever change the terms. The pardon for our sin is the Father's gift. So come receive and confess with voices shouting, we believe that Jesus is our Savior and we've been set free to love. We were purchased on that day and all our sins I paid. Brought us back to life.
happen to be a dog lover, you are in for an extra special treat, because today we have with us Lutheran Church Charities and the division of Lutheran Church Charities, something called the Canine Ministries, which is a little tip off that there are dogs involved. We have five guests on our show today, three humans and two non-humans. We have with us Tim Hetzner, and you are the president of LCC. We also have Kristen Stapleton, and you are one of the dog handlers specifically for the Angel Comfort dog team. And on the end there, we have Rich Martin. You have been volunteering with Canine Ministries for 11 years and on staff with LCC for four. Correct?
Correct.
Yes. And on the floor here, acting very chilled out, we have two of the comfort dogs that we'll be talking about in a little bit. We have Angel here in white, which is very apropos. And we have Luther, who's just over there chilling on the end. Welcome to the show.
Welcome.
Thanks, Lisa.
Thank you.
Well, we'd love to start the show by getting to know you a little bit better, and just personally, and sharing just a little bit about your faith journey. So if you would just spend 2 or 3 minutes and just kind of tell us some of the highlights of your faith journey. Tim, we're going to start with you.
Well, I grew up in a Christian home. And so I was technically a Christian from baptism on. But in my faith walk, there were times that I went to a Lutheran school in the elementary school and then high school, public high school. And I was a little rebellious on that journey growing up and even into college. But went into church work eventually. Was still a little rebellious, but I think in my faith journey, I describe a time of waking up and where my faith become much more real. And that was directly linked to serving others outside the walls of the church that were desperately in need, like in Haiti or Ethiopia or other places. And God just became much more real to me, and I realized that the best teaching of Jesus is doing what Jesus did and touching lives.
And that is a little bit about how the ministry was born,
exactly.
Which we'll come back to you in
exactly.
just a minute.
Exactly.
And thank you for being honest about being rebellious, because I think sometimes people may have kind of a picture of Christianity where people don't enter into rebellious times.
I'm very good at sin.
Yeah.
Very good at it.
Great.
And don't have to practice.
Aren't we all? Kristen, tell us a little bit about your faith journey.
Sure. Well, my journey is very similar to Tim's, actually. I was fortunate enough to be raised in a Christian home. In fact, my family is in church work. My grandfathers are pastors. I have four uncles who are pastors, a dad who is a church musician, a mom who was a teacher. So it was a way of life. That was all I knew. Like Tim, I went to a Lutheran school, and I went to a Lutheran college, but I did rebel a little. I said, I don't want to be like my family. I don't want to go into church work. But God had other plans, and after some trial runs in various professions, I came full circle. And I now work part-time at my church, my husband also. I teach art and help out with the music ministry.
Awesome. So. And then as well as investing your time with the Canine
Ministry. Yes, spent a lot of time with Angel, going places with Angel.
Hear a little bit more about.
Just for the record, we didn't get in trouble together. I just wanted to.
Well, round us out there, Rich. Tell us a little bit about yourself and your faith journey.
Well, I grew up Catholic, went to parochial schools, Catholic boys, all boys high school, and went to work at a very early age. And for 30 years, I was in the retail industry with limited brands, and moved across the country quite a bit. And shortly, a few years after we had gotten married, my wife and I started to look for a church. And had many recommendations, and one was a Lutheran church in Morristown, New Jersey. We took the opportunity on a Sunday morning to go visit the church, and were met with warm welcome arms and big smiles. A pastor that was just right on the money with the sermon. And shortly after that, when we got home, we got a call from one of the members of the church, and they said, well, just calling to see how things were going today, if you liked your experience, what you thought about the church and the service. And, oh, by the way, would you mind if, you know, a couple of us just stopped over tomorrow night? And I said, sure. And not really knowing what to expect, when that knock came on the door, we were kind of expecting a couple of people. Well, God sent a SWAT team. There were five smiling faces that had hearts for Jesus and wanted to share that love of Jesus and make sure that we knew that we were loved and we were saved by grace. And that was our new church home. And as we moved around the country, we became members where we went. And when we came back to Chicago, we found a couple nice church homes here. Mm-hmm. And then as I thought about what I would do in retirement and those things that you say to God that, God, I'd really love to give back.
Yeah.
You know, when I get done with work and I have the time, I'd really love to give back. So I did start looking for opportunities in nonprofits. One was a Countryside Association for People with Disabilities, help people with developmental disabilities, and the other was Lutheran Church Charities. And my wife and I had an opportunity to help out at Katrina and other disasters, not only nationally, but in Haiti. And that was really our start as volunteers.
Yeah, and so that was your way of giving back. You know, and I love the part of your story that talks about, like, you went to a church, they called you up, they sent a SWAT team, they sent five members of the church to your house. And that like the body of Christ showed up for you. And as we were talking about a little bit earlier, that really kind of reignited your faith, didn't it?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So just a reminder that as the body of Christ, we can be there for each other to help people recognize and come to faith. And oftentimes, many of us need a little revival, a little spiritual revival, so we can be that to people as well. And I love the part of your story that reminds us to do that and to be that. Well, tell us, Tim, we're going to come back to you. Tell us a little bit about how was it born, and how did Canine Ministries then come out as a result of starting that?
Well, I started at LCC about 14 years ago, and it was just myself and a half-time person. And now we have a staff of over 30, and we're in national and international ministry. But after being in parish ministry for 25 years, a frustration I always had, and as a director of discipleship, is to get people outside the walls of the church.
Yeah.
And to be Jesus out where people were and where people needed to hear Jesus, and not to just preach to the choir. And so at Lutheran Church Charities, I set up a kind of a DNA of what I wanted it to be. I wanted it to be debt-free and stay debt-free. I wanted dollar in, dollar out, so they knew. And I wanted to share the mercy, compassion, and that presence and proclaim Jesus to those who are suffering and in need. And I started working with churches to help them get outside the walls. So we did disaster response work.
Okay.
And so when Katrina hit, we the next day sent a medical crew of 23 people on a semi of supplies to Metairie, which is right outside of New Orleans. And we were there for like a day and a half when the FEMA asked us if we would do search and rescue for people that had pets. Hmm. Because by law, they couldn't rescue pets. And so many people on the roof of their houses or trapped in their houses would not part with their pets.
Wow.
So we had never done that before.
Wow. But, so what were you thinking when this request came across?
You know, I'm not sure what I was thinking. I'm just saying, well, okay, you know, God puts it in front of you. I mean,
respond.
You know, he doesn't wait for you to know what you're doing. He just teaches you as you do it. So so we got flatboats and all that. And I sent guys down there, and it's... and we did search and rescue people and their pets. But what we saw, and I wish I could say, and the lights went on and I decided to start a dog ministry.
Yeah.
No. God had to hit me on the head a few years later. But what we did see was the bonding between a pet and a person, even to the point that they would risk their life rather than part with their pet. And so it just so happened that we had some volunteers that did disaster response work with us that had some Goldens. And so for disasters, we would ask them just to bring them out and kind of hang out with the people that were coming in that needed assistance and with our volunteers that were going out. And we just saw that, gosh, there's some neat stuff happening here, and you could see God working there. So in 2008, when a shooting took place at Northern Illinois University on February 14th, one of the pastors that was in lockdown on the campus from at Northern Illinois University, called me on a cell phone. He says, Tim, you still do those dog things?
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, yes, he says, they're needed out here. Hmm. So we rounded up, flew in, and brought out dogs to the campus. And I'll never forget it because there was a tent of counselors, you know, on one part of the campus. And then we come out with the dogs, and guess where all the students are?
Hmm.
They're with the dogs.
Mm-hmm.
So we did that. And then in March, or May of that year, the students petitioned the administration to bring the dogs back out. That's when God hit me in the head. Hmm. As all these students came out, and they all had their cell phones, and they all knew the names of the dogs.
Right.
That God said, don't wait for crisis or disaster, start placing dogs in churches.
Interesting.
Now, I grew up on a farm, but I didn't know what I was doing. So in August of 2008, we started with 4 dogs.
Wow.
And today we have dogs in 25 states and continue to grow.
Yeah.
So it just mushroomed. God had this all planned out, and I know that God works in spite of us.
He does, right? And that he gives us many opportunities to hear him. We don't get it the
that's
first
right.
time. Yes, right.
That's
tell
right.
Tell us a little bit about, like, what does the canine ministry look like? What is the purpose of it? And just kind of give us a feel for why you exist.
Well, it follows the same mission as Lutheran Church Charities, to bring the mercy, compassion, presence, and proclamation of Jesus Christ to those who are suffering and in need. And I always have a saying, everyone you know has a problem you don't know about, but do we really take the time? Do we slow down? And do we ask? Mm. And the dogs are a great bridge for ministry. We have a saying at LCC, it's not about the dogs, it's about the person on the other end of the leash that's petting the dog. I mean, that's who we're there for. So when we're in that presence, the best thing that we can do for somebody, because they really don't expect any help from us. They have no expectations from us, mm-hmm. other than to be present and to listen. Mm-hmm. And the biggest tool in our toolbox is prayer. So as people share with us and as the Holy Spirit leads and guides us, we offer prayer at the end of our visits. And we can have, we call them Walmart moments, where we could be in a Walmart just walking down, or in an airport, just walking down the corridor, and people will just drop to their knees, wrap their arms around the dog, and start crying.
Hmm.
And then within minutes, they'll start sharing.
Yeah.
Because the dogs to them are safe. It's a safe environment. I mean, the dogs, as Tim would say, I mean, they keep your secret, they're confidential, they don't take notes.
Mm-hmm.
And so what we do with the ministry is that we get them when they're 8 weeks old. They're all purebred golden retrievers. We work with breeders that have very high standards of breeding that really kind of follow the Golden Retriever Club of America guidelines for breeding. So we look back many years on their health history, eyes, hip, heart, cancer, thyroid. We want to make sure they have a long working life. And equally important is their temperament. So we hand select the puppies out of the litters. And then we started a training school at our Northbrook offices. So at 8 weeks, when we bring them in for training, they're assigned 2 apprentice trainers. And we do that because they get accustomed to being handled by multiple people. Mm-hmm. Because when we place them, the end result is that we place them in churches and schools around the United States. We actually have a dog placed at Concordia University in Mequon, works in the counseling office. But every dog is owned by the ministry organization, so not by an individual.
Okay.
And we have multiple handlers. So they're all trained to work with, like, 6 is what we start with. And then they go home every night to a primary caregiving family that feeds them, exercises them, plays with them, massages right. them. That's what their paycheck is. They
Gosh,
get a massage every
fun.
Night.
That's yeah.
Take,
that, up.
Take
wow.
the best off.
Yeah. Kristen, tell us a little bit about the handling experience, because you're a handler specifically for Angel's ministry, correct?
I am. So Angel is owned by my church, and there are 10 handlers, actually, from
wow.
our membership.
Hmm.
And she lives with me and my husband. So we are handlers, but we are also her primary caregiver. So it's my job every morning to get her up, get her exercised, get her fed, groom her, just get her ready for her day, and get her to the handler or make arrangements for the handler to come and pick her up from us. And we also manage her schedule, which is quite full. Angel spends a lot of time leaving, mm-hmm. in her in schools. That's her primary focus. Our church has a school, so she is in our school about four mornings a week, and then afternoons she goes to various local public schools. Thursdays she spends the better part of a day at a public school, and that involves anything from working with special needs children, working with social workers on one-on-one counseling, reading programs. She does a reading program every Monday morning, and some of that is for kids who have accomplished something and their reward is to sit down and read to Angel. Others, it might be that they are shy about reading out loud, so they have the opportunity to practice with a very non-judgmental, not very critical audience. And it does wonders. The teachers tell us that it really improves their confidence and gives them practice.
Wow, so that's amazing. So what are the qualifications? You talked a little bit, Rich, about the qualifications of a dog, purebred, you look at their temperament, et cetera. What are qualifications of a handler?
Well, handlers need to, number one, want to work for Christ. That's probably the number one criteria. They also need to like dogs. If you don't like a dog, you're probably not going to make a very good handler. But it's a big commitment. We ask our handlers to spend 1 to 2 hours a week at least just training with the dog, and then at least a couple more hours out working with the dog so that she's not always with the same handler. It keeps them on their toes. It keeps them fresh. And it keeps her responding well to all of the handlers. So
Angel specifically stays with you, but she has more than one handler.
Correct.
So you
correct.
Have her on loan to other people that need to.
Okay. Yep.
The dogs love to work, Lisa.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, clearly.
Having multiple handlers, you're not tied to one person's availability.
Yeah.
So the church. Kristen's team developed a ministry plan of where they're going to use the dog in the community. Mm-hmm. And then with the handlers, the other important part is that commitment to the ministry. Because, as you know, ministry happens 24/7. There is no...
Yep.
There are no hands on the clock. There's no dots on the clock for ministry. And you are called. I mean, they have answered calls, unfortunately, for the deaths of young students.
Yes.
We do visitations. Kristen and her team actually went out to Umpqua College last fall with us to respond to the school shooting out there.
Wow.
And I think that's it with what we call deployments out. We respond to crisis and disasters.
Yeah.
And we only go where we're invited in, and we never charge those we serve.
So services are absolutely free.
Our services are
Is the demand ever greater than the supply or your ability to meet, or has it always kind of?
We are sometimes stretched very thin and are deployed out in 3 or 4 crises at one time because of the nature of our country right now.
And you said you're in 25 states at this point.
We're in 25 states.
Great coverage.
Right. And so what we do is when there is a crisis, arrange which dogs are available, can change their schedules and deploy out with us, and then we serve that community where the crisis is, and we'll stay as long as we need to stay. Mm-hmm. In Newtown, we went out with groups of 8 to 10 dogs every week for like 8 weeks, Rich, I think.
Mm-hmm. Really?
And then placed 2 dogs out there, and now we have 3 out there. So we have had a dog in Sandy Hook Elementary School every day since it's opened.
Really?
All the way till now, yep.
Wow.
We've done it, you know, we were down in Orlando this summer, down there for 2 weeks, and have done, I think, 3 follow-up visits down to them, too.
Mm. And now, share two, because we were talking earlier, you shared 2 stories with me. You shared the story of the really tall gentleman that had a lovely interaction with one of the dogs. Tell us about that. Give us a window into what an actual event looks like.
You know, we watch God working, because this was a case where there was 2 cheerleaders that were on a Friday night to a basketball game, and their car slid off and they were both killed. Mm. So we were invited into a rather large high school with the dogs to be with the students for that day, to just help them in their mourning and grieving process. And at that time, I had a dog named Howie, who was kind of the old man. And he was just spread out. I call him a comfort rug with a heartbeat, because, you know, that's kind of what it... And there was this big guy, high school kid next to me that was like 6'6", or just huge. And I kind of, you know, see if he wanted to talk or anything. And he just stoic. And I turned to the side for a minute, and next thing, he is down laying on top of Holly with his arms around him. And so I just let him go. And about 45 minutes later, he gets up and he walks out. Okay. That night, because each of our dogs have their own business.
Yeah, you
car.
Know what? I actually, this is just astounding to me. So Angel is famous. Angel has her own business card. wait, do I don't want to leave Luther out? So Luther, we don't want you to feel, Luther had, they're just chilling. They're not even paying attention. Luther has his own business card too. They have their own Facebook page. Tell me, yes.
Well, the business card was not to be cute. It was to extend the ministry and the touch with the person.
Yes, amazing.
So they keep them because it has their picture on it. And in fact, some of the young kids collect them and they do all that. But Facebook, email, and Twitter.
Yeah.
And so this young man posted on Holly's site, and it turned out.
So there
and
you gave him the
anybody
dog's
that
card.
Touches one of our dogs,
they get
a business card.
They get a business card.
Yep.
Okay.
And each of our dogs, as part of their name, they have a Bible verse.
Oh, fabulous!
And so that's on there too. And so he shared with Howie that one of the young ladies that got killed was his girlfriend, and that started Howie. I had a type for him, but a dialogue. So it was an extension of the ministry. Yeah. And the reason they feel more comfortable talking to the dogs is because they show unconditional love. They have the picture of the dog. They just know that they're not going to be judged. And it's safe. Mm-hmm. See, it's safe. And, you know, Lisa, my goal is in ministry is to help people be more like comfort dogs.
Yeah.
To just be listeners to people. Non-judgmental, show genuine Christ-like love for people, and embrace people. I mean, that's what the dogs do.
Right.
And I think if we could do that, more people would open up. We'd feel more community. And you know, dogs teach us an awful lot.
Yes.
In fact, Howie, you know, worked on a book, you know, Lessons from an Old Comfort Dog.
Oh, wow, that's
you know,
awesome.
And, you know, things like bark less, you know, don't poop on other people's lawns.
So those are good rules to live by.
Yeah. And, but they do teach us a lot, and they are tools and gifts from God. Mm-hmm. And all of creation, Scripture tells us, is to bring glory to God. And so the dogs are used to bring glory to God, and they do. And,
there is something about a pet, as you said. I think there are actually statistics that show the longevity. A person lives longer if they have a pet, right?
That's right.
Kristen, tell us a little bit about, you do a lot of work with children.
Yes.
So tell us about a story that really stands out to you where you had the opportunity to bring one of the comfort dogs
to
a situation.
Well, there's been many.
Yeah.
Last school year, we had the opportunity to work with one young girl who was special needs and was largely nonverbal and oftentimes didn't even appear to engage with people. And the social worker at the school said, I'd really like to try a one-on-one meeting with this girl and Angel. So we said, sure, why not? And she said, please don't overexpect. You know, usually she might make noise, but she doesn't usually speak. In our very first session with her, she pointed to Angel and said, dog.
Oh.
And every week we would see an improvement. Her engagement, her teacher would say, what color is Angel? Angel, white.
Wow.
Is Angel a boy or a girl? Angel, girl. And week by week, we would see this improve. By the end of the school year, she was able to say, I love you, Angel.
Wow.
Which just kind of touched us.
Wow.
So I really feel that there's something, they really are a gift from God.
Yeah.
They really do have the ability to reach people the way that sometimes we can't just by ourselves.
So I was looking a little bit at your website, and I noticed that certain dogs kind of are like, I don't know if it's dog of the month or dog of the year, whatever the case is. One thing I saw that the dogs are recognized in three different categories: companion, hero, and professional. Am I getting that right?
I'm not
well,
sure where
we've received a lot of recognition in different states. A Gracie Comfort dog in Iowa was just named Dog of the Year for the Iowa Veterinary Medical Association.
Just named one of our dogs, a big article in there down from Hilton Head.
Interesting.
So, our dogs get awards, and the dogs are better known than the handlers. I'm going to tell you that straight
up.
Sure. And that's one of the things you have to get used to when you're handling a dog, because get rid of people knowing your name. I mean, they just want to, they'll know the dog's name.
Yeah.
But you know what? That's kind of neat, because that to them, the dog is important. And we have little stuffed dogs. Whenever we go out in a crisis, we always leave a stuffed dog. And one of the most touching pictures that I had was we were in Dallas for the police, when the police were shot down there. And so we were with families, and we were at the funeral of one police officer that died and was with his widow and his young children. And so we were there as thousands of police officers coming through all through the country. But the family wanted us in there by them. And so we gave one of the little girls a dog, and the next day at the funeral, was it the New York Times? One of the New York papers, front cover is the widow holding her daughter at the funeral, and she has the stuffed dog. And she carries that stuffed dog around. So it's kind of a gift from the dogs to people to, you know, the stuffed dogs don't shed, but you know,
You know what I'm curious about is how has this ministry influenced your faith? What would you say? How is being a part of this ministry?
For me, it's been a gold mine to be able to practice my faith and touch people.
Yeah.
You know, it really has. It's they're magnets. Mm-hmm. They're magnets of people from across the room. And the dogs will point out people also. All the time, because they can sense when somebody's really hurting, and they'll just kind of point.
Well, you mentioned that earlier, like they literally can sense when a human being is going through some type of hurt or some type of trauma.
Physical,
it's amazing.
Mental, emotional, they just are so intuitive, and they will oftentimes just pull you right to the human.
Yes. Yep.
Wow.
Yep.
Fascinating.
And so, and again, you don't have to, there's no awkward moments, because people love to pet a dog that's not barking and biting and all that, jumping up, and that, as you can see, they're kind of somewhat relaxed.
Yes, I'm dog's life, let me tell you.
But they are trained to do this.
Right.
And we got to say, you know, people always ask, is that dog dead? And I say, I don't know, you better check him, see if he's breathing.
Well, how do you train them? Because earlier I was asking, like, are they always so chill? And you said they're on the clock right now, and they know they're on the clock when they have their vests on. But if you were to take the vest off and throw a ball, they'd be all happy all over. So
you would never get it back from Luther. First of all, he's a ball hog, and he usually gets three or four in his mouth, and he will not let them go.
That's awesome.
But they're trained not to bark, not to bite, not to lick, not to growl. They don't even give paw. They don't do tricks.
Okay.
You know, many people are afraid of dogs.
Yeah.
You know, or many, especially young children. If you go, we work a lot in the urban areas, and most of the kids, all they know are protection dogs, you know, and attack dogs. So we really have to work with them to relieve their fears. And if you have a dog that's pawing or anxious or can't settle or likes to lick, you know, it's a big turnoff it's a big distraction, and it prevents us from really getting to ministry.
Right.
So our trainers do an amazing job of, there's over 2,000 hours worth of training that goes into these dogs before they're placed. And then when we place the dogs with the teams, we spend 3 full days working on ministry, working on commands. We offer refresher sessions. We have a huge canine conference every year. We had our 6th annual canine conference.
Really? For the dogs and the humans?
350 humans and 100 dogs at the Hilton in Northbrook.
I hope you had a lot of treats. Are they allowed treats?
No.
We don't treat the dogs,
okay.
You know, especially when they're working. Treats is kind of a human thing.
Okay.
And they get their paychecks. Like I said, they get their play, they get their massage. Right. We do work with Nyla Bones or Kongs, the hard rubber things. But they're subject to the same thing humans are, you know, diet and exercise. So okay. We feed them a very high quality dog food and monitor their weight and make sure they get exercise every day. And so they can have a long, healthy working life.
So speaking of working, can we put them to work a little bit here? Do you think they're in the mood to show us a couple of things? Or
well, so, first of all, so this is their A1 comfort position.
Okay.
And as Tim said, you know, people ask you, do you drug the dogs? Or, you know, are they sleeping? And
I've had a lot of people wish they could take on the chill nature sometimes, especially in the stressful environment. Mm-hmm. But yet, do you think they might be willing to...
Do you like dogs? First of all,
I love dogs.
You love dogs.
Yes,
all right.
I
so
love them.
We do a lot of work in hospitals, assisted living, nursing uh-huh. homes, and so one of our
your mic there. Want to grab that puppy.
One of our commands is to, and maybe you could just face your chair this way a little
okay.
bit. Perfect. For chair bound individuals, we would introduce ourselves. Hi, Lisa.
Hi.
My name is Rich.
Hello, I'm Lisa.
Would you like to pet Luther? He's a comfort dog.
I would love to.
Luther, visit.
Hi, sweetie. Hello.
And we would start there.
Aww.
And if you really enjoy the visit and you really like dogs, mm-hmm. Would you like to be a little closer to Luther? He can come up on your lap. He'll put his front
really?
Paws over your lap.
Bring it on. I don't know
All
if he's right. going to fit, but let's see.
Luther, lap. Come on, buddy. Lap. There you go.
Come on.
Come on.
Yay.
All the way.
Oh.
And then that way you can enjoy the visit.
That's so awesome. Oh, what a sweetie. Yeah.
On hospital beds, we do a visit called Rise, and they'll put their two front paws on the edge of the hospital
I
bed
love.
To enable the person to have a really good mm-hmm. close pet.
Mm-hmm. Where are we working you tonight?
Luther never had an anxious bone in his body.
Uh-huh.
He was born with this old soul look on his face.
You're so
and
cute.
He's just stoic.
Yep.
What a sweetie. Angel's jealous, I can tell.
Yeah.
He's like, I want some of the action.
So in Boston, after the marathon, we visited almost every hospital, except for the one that had the perpetrator that was still in it.
Wow.
And in one hospital, there was one of the victims that she was a spectator, and she was waiting at the finish line for her friends to finish. And well, since then, she's had 9 operations.
Wow.
Yeah.
And when we visited her, she was pretty shaken up. Emotionally, physically, she had just undergone like a second operation at the hospital. Didn't know if she would walk again.
Yeah.
And she was missing her two dogs at home, Romeo and Louie. And one of the things that we find is when people are away from home, they miss their pets.
Sure.
They really don't miss their family. They miss their pets.
Hey. Yeah.
And so her rehab person said, well, Michelle, why don't you try taking your first walk today with Luther? And she was very emotional, in tears, but just loved the thought of it. And got in her walker, and Luther led her with
wow.
the walker.
Good yeah. boy. Good boy. That's awesome. Thanks Luther. For visiting me.
There you go.
Oh. Wow.
So the dog really doesn't put weight. You couldn't
I know.
Really,
he was kind of like just, you know.
He snuggled in.
He figured out how to nestle right in there. That's amazing. So how do people find out about your services?
Well, we've had a lot of media coverage from every network. Good Morning America did a show and all that. But it's the big part is word of mouth. Mm-hmm. And through social media, people sharing, and through crises. I mean, when we're brought into it, I'm always amazed of all the public places that we get in with the dogs. And I always say, just so you understand, we're a Christian ministry. We don't hide that. We don't proselytize our faith. But we'll pray with people if they'd want us to, and we don't hide the fact that we're Christian.
Mm-hmm.
Never a problem in a crisis. Never once has somebody said, oh, I didn't realize you're Christian. We can't bring you into our public school. Never once.
Wow.
And so we come in, and we have a very, protocol to work with who their staff are and their social workers as a tool. You know, we do what they want us to do, and we bring in the tools to do it. But I'm always amazed of when you get into a school like that, you may have, you know, 1,000 students. And of course, then they tell their friends. Hmm. And principals talk to principals. And we're just out in schools and doing funerals and gosh, you name it. We also do, we found in crises, is that we spend time with all of our first responders, and that's the police, fire department, and also those that take the 911 calls.
Okay.
Because they're under so much stress because they get the front end, but they never know how it ends up. And they go home at night wondering what happened.
So the dogs will actually go to a 911 responder's
yeah.
home just to provide some
no,
relief?
No, actually from the call center. The operations center.
Yeah, and they take turns coming down, spending time with the dogs. We do it with media, particularly the media in the location where
really?
The... Well, you know, it's media not only have to cover the story, they're
yeah.
also living it.
Right.
And
yeah.
they have long hours and stress. And demands, and we just bring the dogs in, not to be filmed. We just bring them in and say, if you want us to, you can spend time with the dogs. And they're just all over them.
Right.
And,
wow.
But you know, the other thing, and I got to share this about police officers,
yeah.
and it just touched me. You know, Dallas Police Department at roll call, they had three counselors, and each one got up and said, you know, you guys need to talk to somebody, you know, you're living this and stop burying your emotions. And they're going, yeah, 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 yeah. Next one, the same thing. And finally, the psychologist for it. And we're in the back of the room with four dogs. And so they finally dismiss them. And they all get up and they turn around and they smile. And they get down with the dog and they get their cell phone out and they're showing us a picture of them and their dog.
Mm.
Then they're down and taking selfies of themselves with the dogs.
That's awesome.
And then they're texting him. And so I pulled together a couple of the police officers. Who are you texting him to?
Yeah.
Our kids. What'd you say? He says, Daddy's okay. I'm with a comfort dog. Because when they come to work, especially in a situation, their kids are pulling on him saying, Daddy, don't go to work. I don't want you to be killed.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh. These families, we have to minister to families of these police officers, and we need to show respect for them.
Right. You run the gamut. I mean, gosh, newsrooms, police stations, crises.
We have prison ministries. Some of our affiliates work in prisons.
Really?
We
okay.
were working down at the Cook County Jail.
Tell me about that. Yeah, what does that look like?
Well, it just so happens that Eddie Comfort Dog in Nebraska, as part of his introduction into the community, the person that leads the ministry out there, Mo, happened to pass by the correction center one day, and he said, I think I'm going to stop and introduce Eddie to the administration at the prison and see if they would like to use his services. So he goes in and he's talking to, I don't think they call them wardens, but the head of the prison,
uh-huh.
correction center, and introduces the dog. And the man says, well, what does Eddie do? And Mo said, well, can we go back and see some of your people, your detainees?
And they said yes?
He said yes. And he
wow.
took the
dogs
took,
really
took
do have
Eddie.
Like extra
they get you,
special
that's right.
privileges.
Well,
you'd have to know Mo too, but he took Eddie into the back and he met with some of the detainees, some really hardened, the hardest of the hard
wow.
mm-hmm. people, and these big guys just melted.
Yeah.
And it's the same. We saw it at the jail. We were working with a. Another person at the Cook County Jail that does a program there for detainees, and it's the same thing. People are away from their home for whatever reason. They're away from home. They're missing their dogs.
Yeah.
And when they see the dogs, I mean, they just light up. And some of them, again, are afraid of dogs, but when they understand and they get, you know, 2 minutes to put a couple of hands on the dogs, I mean, they just melt.
They're so gentle, yeah.
We have other dogs that work with the court system, work in the state's attorney's office as advocates for children, so preparing for testimony on the stand mm-hmm. when they have to testify, and it just brings a lot of comfort.
But Lisa, this is how God works.
Yeah.
We were trying to get enough dogs as we were growing with this. We were out in Newtown, and one of the places that had called us, like, a year earlier, was the prison in Illinois here.
Dwight
Prison. which is a women's prison.
Okay.
And they heard about us, and they said, we'd like to train your dogs. Well, why would I say no to that?
So the prisoners actually trained
the dogs? Prisoners started training some of our first dogs. And we were getting good dogs, and we had to socialize them a little bit more because they were incarcerated, but
right.
but they were great dogs. So that's going great. I'm out in Newtown, and I get a phone call from the warden that we have to pick up our dogs because Illinois closed down the prison. I'm like, God, why would you do this to us? It's growing, and you're closing one of our training sources and all this. And so I had to come back to Chicago and get these dogs. And then I started getting emails from the staff of it and some of the prisoners that had come out and said, we really like working with you. So I hired the whole staff. I didn't know what to do. I hired the whole staff, and that's how we started the training school, so we could train more dogs. But it was God closing the door, opening up much better. And they were all Christians.
Wow.
And they were all Christians. And so we have another training center out in Nebraska now, where we're training dogs out there, and it's a retired police officer and
just
his wife.
Spreading. Look, when God wants something accomplished, God. Right, thankfully he uses us. Kristen, I wanted to hear a little bit about being a handler and the situations that you go into, which I'm making the assumption some of them are pretty emotionally taxing.
They are.
So how do you take care of yourself in that? And tell me a little more.
When we go on a deployment, and there's a number of us handlers, we all really look out for each other. And at the end of every day, we get together, we call it a debrief, but we talk about what we've experienced and what we've taken on. Because you do, and even the dogs, will start to absorb the grief, the stress that the people we serve are showing. So we make sure we take breaks. Like I said, we look out for each other. Mm-hmm. We talk to each other, we support each other, we pray together. That's the number one thing. That's one of the great side blessings to this ministry is the people that I have become close to in this ministry. It's like a family. We're really there for each other.
That's amazing. So, what are some of the, and any one of you can feel free to respond to this, what are some of the greatest challenges that you face in this ministry?
Trying to keep up with the demand.
Okay.
Trying to keep up to the demand, keeping the quality high always of our dogs and the behavior of our handlers, keeping focused on ministry, because Satan will always try to pull you off course. Mm. And you got to keep the main thing, and not to let Satan try to cause other type of things. And you get literal attacks. We had a team out in Joplin, Missouri, that has two of our dogs, Jackson and Louie. That was 2 months ago. They were in a church van with their whole dog team and their two dogs, leaving at 5 a.m. in the morning. And 5 minutes later, a car in pursuit from police that was armed, shot the back end of the van out and all the side. Two of our handlers and one child was injured.
Oh my word.
One almost died.
Wow.
And both our dogs were shot.
Oh.
And those dogs haven't been able to go out. In fact, I'm going out there this weekend. We're raising money to get them a new van because the insurance company didn't replace the van. It just repaired it. And they see that and they get flashbacks, much like the military people that we work with. And with our Care 9 dogs, so.
Right. Tell us, when we only have like a handful of minutes, tell us just a little bit about that part of the ministry.
The Care 9 ministry?
Yeah, the Care 9,
I'm gonna
yeah.
flip to Rich on
yeah.
that. Rich.
Just give us a little.
It's probably the fastest segment that we serve in our ministry right now. And 2 years ago, we decided that in working with veterans, that veterans most likely and most often like to share their journey with other veterans. So we started with 9 veterans, gave them all puppies, and worked with them to train our dogs to be used in ministry. So we actually don't place dogs with veterans, but they're part of our ministry team. And then we go out now to places like Heinz VA. We work in the Fisher House. It's kind of like the Ronald McDonald House for military veterans. We've been working here in the city with the Veteran Center, RTW, across in Washington Park. We do military stand-downs. We do yellow ribbon events where the We're with the families and the loved ones when they deploy and when they return. We do a lot of military funerals. We do hospice. And again, it's a ministry of presence,
right.
Bringing the mercy and compassion of Jesus Christ to those who are suffering and in need. We have, I think now, almost all of our affiliates are dual vested. So Luther has a camo vest that he wears with the veteran. We're going to go out this Friday to do some veterans events with one of our Vietnam veterans, Terry. And he'll have his camo vest on to identify him as part of the military. The veteran, the plight of the veteran is not great. You see snippets of it, and it's not just the VA, it's just the magnitude of 23 million men and women retired.
Yeah.
The fastest growing segment of the retired are women. The fastest growing segment of active and reservist are women. So it presents another set of conditions and situations that we work down here at Rush with the road home. And so it's just, it's fascinating. And we started an event every month now called 22. Mm-hmm. So on the 22nd of every month from 6 to 8 p.m. in the evening, we provide a dinner free of charge to veterans and their families. And it's to raise awareness about the 22 veterans that take their life every day. 75 attempt, 22 complete the mission. And to raise awareness.
A day.
I didn't know that statistic. That's astounding.
And a lot are our Vietnam era veterans. I mean, probably the biggest segment, the age segment, is 55 to 65. But what we do at that event is camaraderie. It's awareness. We bring in guest speakers. We bring in young veterans that have just been back from Afghanistan or Iraq. We do chaplains. We do moms of sons who've been deployed and talking about. So we look for people to get engaged. We look for congregations, parishes to become more military friendly, to at least know who the veterans are, and not to just celebrate them one day of the year on Veterans Day, but every day. So
right.
We also embrace Red Shirt Friday. So if you see people wearing red shirts, ask them if it's Red Shirt Friday, because it's Remember Everyone Deployed.
Wow, that's awesome. Well, our time together is coming to a close, but tell us, how does one get in contact with you if they say, hey, you know, we would love one of your dogs, your care dogs, to come to our church, to our home?
You can go to our website, LutheranChurchCharities.org, and you can, if you want a visit of a comfort dog, you can fill out a form, and then we'll have somebody get back to you within 24 hours or less. If it's a crisis and you need dogs out for a crisis situation, there's a crisis emergency response form that you can fill out. There's ways to volunteer, disaster response, and we have a toll-free number, 866-455-6466.
Awesome.
And email lcc@lutheranchurchcharities.org.
Great. And, so if you are interested in having a comfort dog, if you'd like to volunteer and look a little bit more into this ministry and how you can be a part of it, we did have the website up for you, so please check it out. It's a great ministry to be a part of, to be the hands and feet of Jesus. Well, it's been a joy to be with you. Can I pray to close this out?
Please
do. Father God, we thank you that Lord, you're just awesome. And we thank you that you have called us to yourself and that you use us, Lord, that you use these your daughter and your sons here before us today to be your hands and feet, God. Your word says that you have come, that you comfort those who mourn, Father. And thank you for the tangible representation in Tim and Rich and Kristen, that you have enabled them to be your ministers of this love and of this compassion. Father, we pray many blessings on them. Lord, I pray that they would just see your hand of favor as they follow you in obedience, God. And I pray that you would expand their territory, God, that you would provide for them in every way so that they can further reach beyond even where you have enabled them to do so thus far. So we love you, Lord. We thank you, and we praise you in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.